I welcome you all in our today's session, that is constraint satisfaction problems. So what is this constraint satisfaction problem? A problem is solved when each variable has a value that satisfies all the constraints of the variable. A problem described in this way is called a constraint satisfaction problem, or in short it is known as CSP. CSP search algorithms take advantage of the structure of states and use general purpose rather than the problem specific heuristics to enable the solution of complex problems. The main idea here is to eliminate large portions of the search space all at once by identifying variable or value combinations that violate the constraints. Now, how to define the constraint satisfaction problems? A constraint satisfaction problem consists of three different components. Those are X, D and C. X is nothing but the set of variables, that is x1, x2 up to xn. D here is the set of domains, that is d1, d2 up to dn. One for each variable. Okay, if there are n number of variables, then there are n number of domains. Now, C is the set of constraints that specify allowable combinations of values. Okay? So, it is nothing but the set of constraints. Each domain Di consists of a set of allowable values, that is v1, v2 up to vk for variable xi. Each constraint Ci consists of a pair of scope REN, where scope is a tuple of variables that participate in the constraint, and REN is the relation that defines the value that those variables can take on. Okay, so it is nothing but the pair of scope and REN. A relation can be represented as an explicit list of all tuples of values that satisfy the constraint, or as an abstract relation that supports two operations, testing if a tuple is a member of the relation and enumerating the member of the relation. For example, if x1 and x2 both have the domain AB, then the constraint saying the two variables must have different values can be written as x1 x2 in square bracket A comma B comma B comma A, or as x1 x2 x1 not equal to x2. To solve a constraint specific problem, we need to define a state space and the notion of a solution. Each state in a CSP is defined by an assignment of values to some or all of the variables. That is xi is equal to vi, xj is equal to vj, and so on. An assignment that does not violate any constraints is called a consistent or legal assignment. A complete assignment is one in which every variable is assigned and a solution to a CSP is a consistent, complete assignment. A partial assignment is one that assigns values to only some of the variables. Now we will consider one example problem here, that is of map coloring. Now suppose that having tire of Romania, we are looking at the map of Australia showing each of its state and territories. which is shown in figure 1E. We are given a task of coloring each region either red, green or blue in such a way that no neighboring regions have the same color. To formulate this as a CSV, we define the variables to be the regions. Okay, so here X is equivalent to, okay, so this is nothing but the set of variables. X is equal to WA, NT, Q, NSW, V, SA, T. Okay, so for each area there is one variable, okay, or for each state there is one variable assigned. So for Western Australia the variable is WA, for Northern Territory there is the variable NT, for Queensland it is Q, for New South Wales it is NSW, for Victoria it is V, for Tasmania it is T, and for South Australia it is SA. The principal states and territories of Australia are shown here. Coloring this map can be viewed as a constraint satisfaction problem. The goal is to assign colors to each region so that no neighboring regions have the same color. In figure B, the map coloring problem represented as a constraint graph. Okay, so here it is a constraint graph. The domain of each variable is the set DI, okay, which is nothing but the set of colors. So domain here is DI is equal to red, green, blue. The constraints require neighboring regions to have distinct colors. Since there are 9 places where regions border, there are 9 constraints. Okay, as there are 9 places, we will consider that there are 9 constraints. Okay, so those are as C is equivalent to SA, not equal to WA. That means the color should not be equal. SA not equal to NT, SA not equal to Q, SA not equal to NSW, SA not equal to V, WA not equal to NT, NT not equal to Q, Q not equal to NSW, NSW not equal to V. Okay, so these are the constraints here. Here we are using abbreviations. SA not equal to WA is a shortcut for SA comma WA comma SA not equal to WA, where SA not equal to WA can be fully enumerated in turn as red comma green comma red comma blue comma green comma red, green comma blue, blue comma red, blue comma green. There are many possible solutions to this problem, such as WA is equal to red and NT is equal to green, Q is equal to red, NSW is equal to green, V equal to red, SA equal to blue, D is equal to red. Okay, so these are the possible solutions. It can be helpful to visualize a CSV as a constraint graph as shown in the figure 1B. The nodes of the graph corresponds to variables of the problem, and the link connects any two variables that participate in a constraint. Now, why to formulate a problem as a CSV? What is the reason behind that? One reason is that the CSVs yield a natural representation for a wide variety of problems. If you already have a CSV solving system, it is often easier to solve a problem using it than to design a custom solution using another search techniques that we have seen in our earlier videos. In addition, CSV solvers can be faster than the state space search because the CSV solver can quickly eliminate large swatches of the search space. For example, once we have chosen SA is equal to blue, then in the Australia problem, we can conclude that none of the five neighboring variables can take on the value blue. So without taking advantage of constraint propagation, a search procedure would have to consider 3 raised to 5, that is equivalent to 243 assignments for the 5 neighboring variables. With constraint propagation, we never have to consider blue as a value. So we have only 2 raised to 5, that is equivalent to 32 assignments to look at. A reduction of almost 87% here. With CSPs, once we find out that a partial assignment is not a solution, we can immediately discard further refinements of the partial assignment. Furthermore, we can see why the assignment is not a solution. We see which variables violate a constraint. So we can focus attention on the variables that matter. So as a result, many problems that are intractable for regular state space search can be solved quickly using the CSP, or then they are formulated as a CSP. Now we will consider one more problem here. Okay, that is the example problem of job shop scheduling. So factories have the problem of scheduling a day's worth of jobs subject to various constraints. In practice, many of these problems are solved with CSP techniques. Now consider the problem of scheduling the assembly of a car. The whole job is composed of tasks, and we can model each task as a variable here, where the values of each variable is the time that the task starts, expressed as an integer number of minutes. Constraints can assert that one task must occur before another. For example, a wheel must be installed before the hubcap is put on, and that only so many tasks go on at once. Constraints can also specify that a task takes a certain amount of time to complete. We consider a small part of a car assembly consisting of 15 tasks. Install axle, front and back. Affix all 4 wheels, right and left, front and back. Tighten nuts for each wheel. Affix hubcaps and inspect the final assembly. We can represent the tasks with 15 variables here. That is, X is equivalent to XLF, XLB, WheelRF, WheelLF, WheelRB, WheelLB, NutsRF, NutsLF, NutsRB, NutsLB, CapRF, CapLF, CapRB, CapLB, and inspect. The values of each variable is the time that the task starts. Next, we represent precedence constraints between individual tasks. So whenever a task T1 must occur before task T2, and task T1 takes duration D1 to complete, we add an arithmetic constraint of the form T1 plus D1 should be less than or equal to T2. In our example, the axles have to be in place before the wheels are put on, and it takes 10 minutes to install an axle. So we can write here as XLF plus 10 less than or equal to WheelRF. XLF plus 10 be less than or equal to WheelLF. XLB plus 10 be less than or equal to WheelRB. XLB plus 10 less than or equal to WheelLB. Next, we say that For each bill, we must affix a bill, which takes 1 minute. Then tighten the nuts, 2 minutes. And finally, attach the hubcap, 1 minute, but not represented yet. So, can we rewritten as bill RF plus 1 less than or equal to nuts RF? Nuts RF plus 2 less than or equal to cap RF. Wheel LF plus 1 less than or equal to nuts LF, and nuts LF plus 2 less than or equal to cap LF. Wheel RB plus 1 should be less than or equal to nuts RB, and nuts RB plus 2 be less than or equal to cap RB. Wheel LB plus 1 less than or equal to nuts LB, and nuts LB plus 2 less than or equal to cap LB. Suppose we have 4 workers to install wheels, but they have to share one tool that helps put the axle in place. Now we need a disjunctive constraint to say that axle F and axle B must not overlap in time. Either one comes first or the other does. So here XLF plus 10 less than or equal to XLB, or XLB plus 10 should be less than or equal to XLF. This looks like a more complicated constraint combining arithmetic and logic, but it still reduces to a set of pairs of values that XLF and XLF can take on. We also need to assert that the inspection comes last and takes 3 minutes. So for every variable except inspect, we add a constraint of the form x plus dx should be less than or equal to inspect. Finally, suppose there is a requirement to get the whole assembly done in 30 minutes. So we can achieve that by limiting the domain of all variables. So di is equivalent to 1, 2, 3 up to 27. Okay, we have left the remaining 3 minutes for inspection. The simplest kind of CSP involves variables that have discrete finite domains. Okay, now here we are going to see the variations on the CSP formulas. So map culling problems and scheduling with time limits are both of this type. Okay, so these are the simplest kind of CSPs. Okay, which involves variables that have discrete and finite domains. Now we are going to consider the 8 queens problem that we have seen earlier. So this can also be viewed as a finite domain CSP, where the variables Q1 to Q8 are the positions of each queen in the column 1 to 8. And each variable has the domain di is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. A discrete domain can be infinite, such as the set of integers or strings. If we didn't put a deadline on the job scheduling problem, there would be an infinite number of start times for each variable. With infinite domains, it is no longer possible to describe constraints by enumerating all allowed combinations of values. So instead, a constraint language must be used that understands constraints such as T1 plus D1 should be less than or equal to T2 directly, without enumerating the set of pairs of allowable values of T1 and T2. Now, spatial solution algorithms exist for linear constraints on integer variables. That is, the constraints such as one just given in which each variable appears only in linear form. It can be shown that no algorithm exists for solving general nonlinear constraints on integer variables. The constraint satisfaction problems with continuous domains are common in the real world and are widely studied in the field of operation research. For example, the scheduling of experiments on the Hubble Space Telescope requires very precise timing of observations. The start and finish of each observation and maneuver are continuous valued variables that must obey a variety of astronomical precedence and power constraints. The base known category of continuous domain CSPs is that of linear programming problems, where constraints must be linear equalities or inequalities. Linear programming problems can be solved in time polynomial in the number of variables. The problems with different type of constraints and objective functions have also been studied here, that is quadratic programming, second order conic programming and so on. In addition to examining the types of variables that can appear in CSPs, it is useful to look at the types of constraints. The simplest type is the unary constraint, which restricts the value of a single variable. For example, in the map coloring problem, it could be the case that South Australians won't tolerate the color green. We can express that with the unary constraint SA, SA not equal to green. Okay, so South Australia should not be equal to green. A binary constraint relates two variables. So for example, SA not equal to NSW is a binary constraint. A binary CSP is one with only binary constraints. It can be represented as a constraint graph as in figure 1b. We can also describe higher order constraints, such as asserting that the value of y is between x and z, that the ternary constraint between x, y, z. A constraint involving an arbitrary number of variables is called a global constraint. One of the most common global constraints is ALLDEF, which says that all the variables involved in the constraint must have different values. In Sudoku problems, all variables in a row or column must satisfy an ALLDEF constraint. ALLDEF stands for all variables should be different. Another example is provided by cryptarithmetic puzzles. Each letter in the cryptarithmetic puzzle represents a different digit. For the case in figure 2a, this would be represented as the global constraint ALLDEF, F T U W R O. So here figure 6.2a shows a cryptarithmetic problem. Each letter stands for a distinct digit. The aim is to find a substitution of digits for letters such that the resulting sum is arithmetically correct, with the added restriction that no leading zeros are allowed. So here TWO plus TWO is equal to FOUR. So each letter here stands for a distinct digit. Okay, the figure B here shows the constraint hypergraph for the cryptarithmetic problem, showing the ALLDEF constraint. that is the square box at the top, as well as the column addition constraints, the four square boxes in the middle, and the variables C1, C2, C3 represents the carry digits for the three columns. Okay, so this square represents the ALDIF constraint. These four squares represent the column addition constraints, and C1, C2, C3 are nothing but the carry digits. The addition constraints on the four columns of the puzzle can be written as the following N array constraints. O plus O is equal to R plus 10 into C10. C10 plus W plus W is equal to U plus 10 into C100. That is the carry at 10th position, carry at 100th position, and carry at 1000th position. Okay, so in this way, C100 plus T is equal to 0 plus 10 into C1000 should be equal to F, where C10, C100 and C1000 are auxiliary variables representing the digit carried over into the 10th, 100th and 1000th column. These constraints can be represented in a constraint hypergraph, such as the figure shown, or such as the one shown in the figure 2b. A hypergraph constraint of ordinary nodes, that is the circles in the figure, and hypernodes, these squares, which represent N array constraints. Now, alternatively, every finite domain constraint can be reduced to a set of binary constraints if enough auxiliary variables are introduced. So, we would transform any CSP into one with only binary constraints. This makes the algorithm simple. So, another way to convert an N array CSP to a binary one is a dual graph transformation. So, here create a new graph in which there will be only one variable for each constraint in the original graph and one binary constraint for each pair of constraints in the original graph that share variables. Now, for example, here if the original graph has variables x, y, z and constraints x, y, z, c1 and x, y, c2, then the dual graph would have variables C1, C2 with the binary constraint X, Y, R1. So here X, Y are the shared variables and R1 is the new relation that defines the constraint between the shared variables as specified by the original C1 and C2. There are, however, two reasons why we might prefer a global constraint such as ALDIF rather than a set of binary constraints. So first, it is easier and less error prone to write the problem description using ALDIF. Second, it is possible to design special purpose inference algorithms for global constraints that are not available for a set of more primitive constraints. The constraints can be described so far have all been absolute constraints, violation of which rules out the potential solution. So many real-world CSPs include preference constraints indicating that which solution are preferred. For example, in a university class scheduling problem, there are absolute constraints that no professor can teach two classes at the same time. But we also may allow preference constraints. That is, Professor R might prefer teaching in the morning, whereas Professor N prefers teaching in the afternoon. A schedule that has Professor R teaching at 2 p.m. would still be an allowable solution. So unless Professor R happens to be the department chair, but would not be an optimal one. So preference constraints can often be encoded as costs on individual variable assignments. For example, assigning an afternoon slot for Professor R costs 2 points against the overall objective function, whereas the morning slot costs 1. With this formulation, CSPs with preferences can be solved with optimization search methods, either path-based or local. We call such a problem as a constraint optimization problem or COP. So linear programming problems do this kind of optimization, that is the constraint optimization problems. So in this session we have seen the constraint satisfaction problems. We have discussed about the example problems of color mapping as well as the job shop scheduling. Okay, so also we have discussed about the formulation or formalization of the variables. Okay, so I hope this session will be helpful for your further studies. Thank you.